I'm not going to sugarcoat it. The entire drama surrounding Pokemon Sword and Shield is absolutely terrible. They say that they're going to cut Pokemon from the game, and people were upset by that, but if I'm going to be honest, I was happy with the news. I'm a casual player that only cares about the new Pokemon in the new games. I've never completed the Pokedex because that's not fun for me, and I don't care about the competitive scene because I also find that boring. The Dexit fiasco sounded great to me, but then you get to the allegations of Game Freak reusing the models from the 3DS games even though they said they plan to update the models and animations to make it more lively. But here's the takeaway from this. First of all, the community has been far too toxic about the whole issue. The fans are acting entitled. It doesn't matter whether or not the fans are entitled or not. They are acting entitled, and it has now harmed the image of the community. People keep claiming that criticism is not toxicity, but the fact is that these aren't criticisms. Nothing has been a criticism. Nobody had even played the game, so you couldn't have actually criticized anything. Everything so far has been baseless accusations without anything to really back it up. The only true thing we could criticize is the reduction of Pokemon in the game. However, do the fans have a solid platform for these complaints given that Pokemon is the world's largest franchise and that they should be putting more money into improving their games? Number two, this whole fiasco hasn't done a lot of good for the community. The general fanbase clearly doesn't care, seeing as Pokemon is still selling like crazy, and the people who are upset by it have been taking on a reactionary approach to the whole issue. And yes, it's been reactionary. You guys didn't even play the game and you were already canceling it. That's reactionary. If you ask me, the outcry from the core fanbase only shows that the Pokemon games don't deliver on the experience they want, even though Pokemon hasn't really changed that much on a fundamental level. I'd argue that it's the fans that need to play a different game. Number three, as for my personal interpretation of this ordeal, I'll be blunt. I'm not a game developer, and I'm not going to pretend I know anything about developing a game. Even with the argument of Pokemon being the largest franchise, we don't know what budget Game Freak is working with to develop the game. We don't know how the money is being handled or what they have to do to get the game finished. The fans are making a lot of assumptions without a good knowledge about how business is run, and I think a lot of the accusations that are being made are made from ignorance. Here's the argument that reactionaries are making. Game Freak claimed that they had to cut Pokemon out of the new Pokemon game because they needed to update the models and the animations. But the fans argue that they are not new models in the new game. People usually point to the wireframes that have been circulating the internet as evidence to where the models aren't the same, but wireframes aren't the same as full 3D models. Luckily, Laura Miller, who's worked on games like The Division, has spoken out against these images. She said, "These wireframe comparison images have no source. It seems to originate from somewhere on 4chan, then back to Twitter again. There is literally nothing to support this data mine actually happened. Two, I could fake these screenshots in under an hour by selecting one of two identical models and a 3D viewport, which would create these black and white outlines. Three, it's impossible to judge development decisions without working on the game. Anyone calling themselves a dev who shits on other people's work is unlikely to have made a game at all. It's a small industry and there's no better way to show you're horrible to work with." Laura went so far as to fake the images herself, which even further shows how these images aren't credible for criticizing the game. I can't even find a proper source for the original images. It's gotten so ridiculous that others are faking images just to further prove the point. However, Laura did reply to my messages, and after asking if I could use her tweets, she mentioned this. "Feel free to use my tweets as long as you're aware that I never said that they were fake. Only easily faked, and have since seen posts which show they're more likely real. I just don't think that should affect opinions of the game, personally. This outrage just makes devs less likely to want to talk to players about their game pre-release, which is bad for everyone." She followed up by saying, "I saw a dump with some old models, but which this time included new textures. I'll see if I can dig out the link for you." And she actually sent me the link from DJTHED Games, where he looked over the wireframe and compared it to the previous models of previous games. And according to him, he says that the wireframes are only slightly different and don't have enough differences to be of anything worthwhile.
Some side-by-side comparisons, check for timings in the animation. Timings is very important to check for similarities. In fact, probably the most important thing. If the timings for all the movements are the same, it's likely that the animation is the same. It can't account for like minor tweaks, but it would prove that the animations are not significantly different either, which to an extent is already kind of proven, but I'll probably have to do more in-depth work on that to make that more of a satisfactory, to make that more satisfactory. The models from Sword and Shield, they're not significantly different. Even Pikachu isn't significantly different. Pikachu just has a new mouth and nothing else in terms of the model itself. Unfortunately, no armatures, so that means I can't check vertex weights. I can't check bone placement. So even though I do include those to be part of the model, I can't check that right now. So all I can check is the wireframe itself, which is part of the model. Models are not significantly different. The most significant changes other than Pikachu is some slight adjustments to positioning of some of the vertices. Like for Eevee, they straightened out the tail because that would be a more ideal T-pose. And they also had some modeling passes that aren't just related to the rig. They straightened out Glaceon's head shape. They made it less bulgy around the ear base. I haven't looked at every model. I have not. That would take a lot of time to do in Blender. But yeah.
For the sake of argument, I'm going to choose to ignore the wireframes for now, because I feel it detracts from the main point. And the main point is, does all this actually matter? If the game is fun and people enjoy it, then why should we care if they're making it easier for themselves to develop these games? Now keep in mind, it's not the fact that Game Freak reused old models that are making the fans upset. It's the fact that Game Freak said they're not going to reuse old models, and all the evidence point to the fact that they did. There is minor changes to some models, but it's not enough to justify getting rid of half of the Pokemon in the game. I can make some guesses as to why they decided to reduce the amount of Pokemon in the game. First of all, I think it's clear that Game Freak didn't tell the fans how many Pokemon were being cut from the game because they knew there would be a lot of backlash, and if they just kept their mouths shut, they could maximize the amount of pre-orders before the game's actual launch and the announcement of how many Pokemon were actually cut. But the real reason, I would argue, as to why they cut Pokemon from the game is so that they could have more control with how they market the game and how they push future releases. Imagine a few years from now, the fans are used to the games not having all their favorite Pokemon. If Game Freak decided they needed the next Pokemon game to sell well, they'll make a special announcement saying that the fan favorites, like Lucario, Infernape, Zoroark, Gardevoir, all the legendaries, you name it, they're all in the next game. Instead, fans will get excited that their favorite Pokemon is coming back, and that will push sales of newer games. If you ask me, I'd argue that's the biggest reason why they made the decision to cut Pokemon. The argument that new models being made for future console generations also makes sense, and I'm willing to believe that, but some argue that they should have enough money to outsource the modeling and animation, which makes sense, but we don't know the work culture at Game Freak. They could choose to keep all the modeling and animation done in-house to make sure it keeps up with their standard of their holistic image. And we honestly don't know how their money is distributed between them. Nintendo, the Pokemon Company, which is actually separate from Game Freak, and whoever else is involved, chances are they don't actually have as much money as we'd like to think. And I see fans saying that the games should be AAA quality, which is understandable given the fact that Pokemon is the world's largest franchise. But the truth is, they really can't. At least, not yet. Pokemon has to maintain the round, cartoony, simple imagery that it has now, because if they went to high-definition 4K models, that would ostracize the player base even more than them cutting Pokemon from the game. And this is coming from someone who really wants a game with 4K hyper-realistic models, because I think that'd be the coolest thing in the world. But if they did make a game like that, it would just alienate the fans much more than Sword and Shield already has. But here's the worst thing about this whole situation. People are making these claims, people are judging the game before they had actually even played it. And that's the biggest reason why everyone outside looking in feels that the Pokemon fans are being entitled. Because let's face it, you are. And the one thing you should never do is judge a game or any piece of media before you actually play it. Which is why I waited to make this video until after I played and beat the game. So, how was the game? Fishing only in certain areas. That's fine with me. I don't get why people are complaining about that. Forced experience share. I actually love this, because all I see is them trying to eliminate grind from the game, and I always hated the tedium of leveling up my Pokemon because I always want to level them up all just to see their evolutions. This was a great move to me. I really prefer Pokemon appearing as actual models while exploring the tall grass. I can easily avoid the Pokemon I don't care about or have already caught. The way the game pauses all the people and Pokemon when you're climbing a ladder is weird, and I don't know why they did this. The animations were cherry-picked hard. Some of these moves look boring and sad, but then you have this. I'd say that the effort was just put towards the moves that were more important. I mean, who's going to keep Double Kick anyway? Except me. Throughout the entire game. The animations, for the most part, are fine. The game is just as charming as it's always been. The environments are actually gorgeous. I love what they've done with everything. I was never bored with the environments at any point throughout the game. The wild area not allowing you to catch high-level Pokemon is just wrong. I'll admit that I sort of get why, but if a player wants to take on the challenge of catching a super powerful Pokemon, then the game should let them. The game, if you ask me, is actually really great. I'm frankly surprised at how much I like it. There's some bits where they could do a better job, but I'm not going to hold a gun to their head, and the game isn't too easy as some people claim. Pokemon games have never really been hard. We've just gotten better, so it feels easy. That's why Nuzlockes were created. It's still a game that needs to be approachable for kids, and though I agree that kids aren't stupid, they simply don't have the capability to comprehend everything about Pokemon with their first playthrough. Frankly, the anger towards Game Freak is just wrong. Yes, all signs point to them lying about the models, but that doesn't mean they were being lazy when making the game. Hell, I'd go so far as to argue they should be reusing assets like this, now that it appears they're being pushed to make a new Pokemon game every year. We should want their jobs to be easier. Game development is tedious, and demanding so much from them is only asking for them to enforce harsher crunch times on their employees. We should be happy they're making quality games without needing to exert as much of their time. And only when Game Freak releases a bad Pokemon game will I start arguing that they need to make changes. Even with Sun and Moon, they released a sequel because they knew Sun and Moon wasn't all that good. Game Freak doesn't deserve this.